The equivalent of the Zurich structure is usually reached in the Dutch defense by an exchange on e6 rather than on d4, like in the King's Indian. There are some cases where black plays e5 and he takes d4 in the Dutch too, but once you reach e5, you rather have the temptation to play e4 to gain more space if allowed. Or sometimes white may answer e5 with d takes e5, and for some reasons black needs to take with the knight when we would reach the same structure. But the most typical way of reaching this structure is when white takes en passant on e6. Now we can see that indeed the position is similar to a certain extent to the King's Indian. Actually, the knight trajectory is very much the same. The knight is heading for c5. True, in the King's Indian, it would usually reach that square via d7, but here knight a6 is the typical move because d6 needs protection. And then we start noticing some differences, because in the King's Indian, black would usually play queen b6 and a5, and eventually a4, so to slow down a white's queenside attack or even anticipate it by starting an attack himself. But queen b6 is not so common in this structure in the Dutch defense. First of all, because the d6 pawn is kind of hanging, there is no knight on d4, no white knight on d4 yet, and also because with the king side slightly weakened, the queen rather belongs on e7, and this leads us to a regrouping such as this one, very central piece placement, very active. There is a mention about white's possibility to attack this bishop. And well, usually there are two main options. One of them is just leaving it there, defending it, or if the queen was on a7 already, continuing with rook a8. Then okay, white would get the bishop spare, but at the same time he would help black keep his continue his development. And the other possibility would be to retreat with the bishop to c8, but this is better done when the rook is already on d8, because such a regrouping with the bishop back, the bishop is actually active on its initial square. The only problem is that it does not allow the rook connection. So after rook a8, bishop c8 is a perfectly viable move. It defends f5, allowing at some point an attack with h6 and g5, and it's well placed. It doesn't stand in the way of the other pieces. This is very abstract now. The main problem is to understand what should be black doing in this structure, because I remember when I started playing the Dutch defense for the first time around the age of 15, so more than 30 years ago. One model game for white was this one, Ullmann-Zweig, and this was the typical case when black had allowed some exchanges in the previous phase. We see that there is only one minor piece each left on the board, and this is the kind of situations when somehow black's space advantage on the king side starts turning into a weakness. Actually, now we can see that g5 followed by f4 is not possible because the e4 knight is hanging. Sometimes black has to count its bishop takes e4 followed by the capture on d6. Let's say it's not so easy to accomplish that yet, but he has to permanently watch that. And what is more disturbing is that white can effortlessly start a queen side attack with b4 b5. That's the most that's the biggest stress that black has, and it's not, let's say, a decisive attack. But it opens a file, the B file, and then the queen would come to A4, attacking C6 and A5, A7. So this is a permanent source of worry for Black, who simply is slightly worse. Let's play a few moves from the game. It's like played knight G5. The idea is to transfer the knight onto a more stable position on F7 to defend D6 properly. Probably he still hoped for G5 and F4, but somehow White's attack is much faster. Before, the set is simple: B5, CB is not a solution because Rook D5 and the bishop. Anyway, the bishop will become very strong in just a few moves. Queen E7. Probably he prepares to transfer the queen to c7. And well, actually there was nothing wrong with b5 now. It simply creates a target on c6. But what Ullmann did is I'm not sure if it's better, but it's interesting. He provoked this weakening, and now he played b5. He wanted to make sure that the queen side gets opened. Of course, this exchange may seem to favor Black because, okay, now he has better central control, but at the same time, the problem is that White will have this passed pawn on the A file, very dangerous passed pawn. White cannot display any activity based on C5 because D5 would be hanging. So after B takes C6, B takes C6, A5, he will have to worry about the passed pawn and about his weakened king side. Actually, all these weaknesses and the combined threats eventually allowed Ullmann to make a combination which remained famous. It can be found in several books of combinations. But for our purpose, it's just enough to conclude that Black should plan his play between the opening and middle game in such a way that he does not reach a dead point, a dead end. Because if he does that, then it's very possible that White would win the game by just making simple moves, b4, b5, and occupy the open file and eventually take a pawn. So now, coming back to the position we discussed initially, the structure, you remember that the regrouping with Queen E7 and the rooks on the E and D file is very central somehow. It gives a feeling of force. So it means that Black's chances should be looked not on the queen side, but in the center. And he has two main possibilities to do that, using the E4 square and advancing d5, gaining space in the center with d5. And we will treat these two items separately.